Hello, in this video we're going to be looking at the SkyWatcher AZ-GTi Wi-Fi connecting altazimuth mounting and tripod and the AZ-GTi telescope range. Hello? It's for you, again. This little mount is feature-packed, but the primary advantage of the AZ-GTi is the built-in Wi-Fi module, allowing it to be controlled wirelessly via your smartphone or tablet using SkyWatcher's free SynScan app for iOS or Android. The AZ-GTi creates its own Wi-Fi network, and the mount and the free SynScan app taken together provide a full computerized go-to system. The AZ-GTi also sports SkyWatcher's latest Freedom Find dual encoder technology, so your telescope can be moved locks-free manually in either axis without losing its position. Now, before we start going into detail about this compact, diminutive altazimuth mount with its Wi-Fi connection system, the AZ-GTi, let's just drop back and give you a helicopter view of the telescopes in the range, in the AZ-GTi range. We're not going to go into minute detail about these telescopes because we've done that, I think, fairly extensively in part of our back catalogue. And you will see some links appearing on your screen that will take you to other videos in our series, where we've had a lot more to say about each of these tubes, and you're obviously welcome to go there and study that. But for the time being, we're only going to sort of skim over the tubes a little bit and just give you a flavour of what's included with each of the telescopes. Let's kick off with the big gun in the range, the SkyMax 127. We've got 1500 millimetres of focal length here, 127 mil aperture. The telescope is supplied with the usual two modified Achromat eyepieces, the 25mm and the 10. All of the telescopes in the range are supplied with these. We've told you many times before they probably need upgrading. The 10mm in particular isn't really good enough for all these telescopes, but the 25 will function relatively well, but the 10mm could do with being upgraded at some point. All models in the series come with a red dot finder with an adjustable brightness control on that, an ideal way of finding targets in the night sky. And the two Maksutov Cassegrains are both supplied with mirror star diagonals. You can do terrestrial viewing of a very high powered kind with these two telescopes, but do bear in mind they are both somewhat high gear when it comes to delivering magnification and tend to be a little bit overpowered. The 102 here, SkyMax 102, we've got 1300mm of focal length. Don't get confused, it's all folded up into this diminutive sized tube. We've got 102mm of aperture here, an excellent telescope for looking at targets like the moon and planets, as well as brighter targets in the deep sky as well. Also included in the range is the very excellent 130PS. This is a very tried and tested favourite in the SkyWatcher range, 130mm of aperture. This is a Newtonian reflecting telescope, 650mm of aperture, a great all-rounder, producing lovely views of the moon and planets, but also great views of deep sky targets as well. Now again, that's a very thin discussion of these telescopes, but I do want to recommend that you go to our back catalogue where we've dealt with these instruments in a little bit more detail. Of course, we're going to look at the Wi-Fi connectivity of the AZ-GTi in just a moment in some detail. But first of all, let's just get the large scale details of the mount and how it comes to you in the package out the way first. The mount and tripod and extension pillar comes as a three-piece kit. You can purchase that separately, of course, so you can buy the AZ-GTi as a tripod kit. As far as I know, the head, they haven't decided to make the head available on its own yet, but certainly the tripod head and pillar is available in one kit. The way the kit is supplied in all the telescopes in the range as it stands at the moment is identical, so you get the head, the tripod and the extension column in all of the AZ-GTi telescope ranges. The tripod we've looked at before, it's the same tripod and extension pillar that we've seen on the Pronto that we looked at recently, and also the AZ-5. So I'm not going to go into too much detail about that. You can go back to the our back catalogue maybe and take a look at that if you want to see any more detail. Important details are that the height of the tripod up to here is 114 centimeters, that's about 45 inches, and right to the top here is 135 centimeters, that's about 53 inches. The weight of the tripod's about 4 kilos all in, just a whisker under, and the head weighs in at about 1.3 kilos, so certainly not going to strain you actually carrying this gear around. Okay, the mount head itself, let's just take a look at the gross details of the mounting. You can see it's very small and neat. We've got a nice, easy to operate locking system on the altitude. And one of the first things you can see, we've got a lock on the azimuth here as well. Quite small, but not difficult to operate, and gives me a good feel for the amount of pressure that I'm putting on there to actually lock it up. But one of the first things that you can see is that I can operate the mount completely manually. Now this is a nice feature. If you just want to plonk a telescope on the mounting and take it outside and start using it, no need to connect up any electronics. You can just put your telescope on and start using it. I have to be honest, I quite like that feature, because I find electronic mounts of the relatively recent past that have permanently engaged drive systems, especially in their azimuth system, a little bit tedious to have to power everything up every time you just want to take a look at the moon or take a quick look at something, maybe even terrestrially. So being able to use it manually, I think, is a nice feature. Other obvious details, we use the standard 45mm cradle system on here, very neat. Payload carrying capacity of the mount might be worth mentioning at this stage, as we've just been talking about the tripod. Manufacturer pegs that at around about 5 kilos. All of the telescope tubes available on the skit in the kits are way less than that, so there's no problem there at all. I would say that payload rating is at the upper edge of what it's capable of controlling. I think if you were putting alternative telescopes on here, you'd want to come in on the south side of that 5 kilos and certainly not exceed it. And I'd also be nervous, I think, of putting relatively long telescope tubes if I was getting anywhere near that 5 kilo limit. I'd only be happy being up around the 5 kilo mark if the telescope OTA was relatively puckered up and quite short and very much over the middle of what the mount is doing. And that's simply a reflection of the fact that this is a diminutive mounting, and I think as I handle it here in front of you, you can see that there's a limit of what can be expected of these relatively small bearing surfaces. So definitely a word of caution there not to exceed the payload weight by too much. Let's just add one little point there about the connectivity of the mount to tripods. You can see that the base fitting on the AZ-GTi uses the standard 3.8 Whitworth, or 3.8 UNC as it's sometimes called, otherwise often referred to as prosumer tripod fitting point. This will enable you to put the mount on any good quality photographic tripod, professional grade photographic tripod. Do remember though that it wouldn't be safe to operate the mount with a telescope on. I think if the tripod still had its tilting or ball head function at the top. You would want to remove that before putting this unit on your tripod. Let's just tick off some of the other external features of the mount that we can see here. Let's take a little look at the battery chamber. It's a nice simple utilitarian operation. The fairly standard battery pack here takes 8 AA batteries. Just slip that back inside. That accounts for about 10% of the weight once you've got the batteries in there, I think, one way or another. Coming round to the front here, let's just look at the control panel. The first socket is very useful. We can connect a standard V4 or V3 SynScan handset controller into here if you have one, or if you wish to buy one separately. Don't forget, this is not included. The method of operation of this mounting is through a handheld smartphone or a tablet. So this is just offering you another option for controlling it. Consequently, connectivity with the mount, which is an evolving process, because there are lots of new things that are coming along, but obviously anything that can exploit the SynScan control system can access this through the ASCOM control system, and things like Sky Safari can also be connected to it as well, and there are other products emerging on the market that could give you levels of connectivity that can get around the need for this handset, as well as of course the onboard Wi-Fi system that we're going to be looking at. Other features on the front here are an independent power supply function so that we can plug 12 volts. It's actually 7 volts to about 14 volts it can actually be powered on, but a typical battery power supply is going to be 12 volts or maybe 13.8 if you are running it from a motor car or something like that. The next switch along here is the snap function, which enables the mount to be connected to a digital SLR that would be connected to it. There are no, according to the manufacturer, there are no accessories actually included for that. I have to say though, all of the mounts that we've received so far all have Canon camera connection cables. The literature supplied with it says that cables are not included, and also the importer's website indicates that cables are not included, but all the ones we got actually had cables in. Maybe that's something that's not going to be on the mountings that are available from a dealer near you. And then finally the on and off switch at the end there. Okay, so let's connect it up. I'm using it with an iPhone. You can download the free SynScan app from the App Store if you're using an iOS device like this, or you can download the app for the Android system from Google Play. Before I run the app, I need to power up the mounting. That's the first operation. And it'll begin putting out its own Wi-Fi signal. So one of the first things I've got to do is make sure I can connect to that. So I'm going to look at my Wi-Fi choices, and it comes up straight away down the bottom here. You can see SynScan and a little number after it. I'm just going to accept that, and it's connected up. I then go to the app. This app is completely free, of course, so you can download this immediately and start having a look at it. Just run it up. First of all, straight away you can see that it's come up in a red screen mode, and that's because the sun has actually set and it's dark outside, so it's actually showing me automatically. You can toggle between red screen and normal by simply going into the settings. But it did it here, as you can see, completely automatically. So the first thing I've got to do is hit connect at the top of the screen here, which I'm going to do. And it begins searching for the, and it's done it straight away. We're connected up. I can demonstrate that it's connected just to make sure everything is well by looking at the telescope control panel just at the bottom here. And I'm going to speed up the rate so that you can see it moving. I'm going to toggle it across to value number 9 just by hitting that little arrow there. There you go. So we're fully connected. That's great. Now, another really great feature of the app controlled system is that the critical information like the date and time and my position on the Earth's surface, well, that's all taken care of already by the smartphone, so I haven't got to put any of that information in. That's already laid on for me. The one thing I have got to do is I've got to line the mount up, or rather the telescope tube anyway, while it's on the mount, with 2 alignment stars. I've got to communicate to the mount exactly where the telescope is pointing, and this is a critical step to make sure that all the other moves made by the mount and telescope system are accurate. So let's do that now. Just click on the alignment icon on the screen here. I've got a couple of options come up: brightest star alignment and north level alignment. Now, we've encountered north level before on a rival brand telescope. That is actually patent controlled to be on a handset, but on a device like this, it's open season on that, and it's great to see that on this app. What I really like about level north is the principle of operation is basically, again, knowledge free. We can simply pick the alignment stars from a list. We don't have to know where they are in the sky. So there's no critical requirement here for you to actually know where the alignment stars are in the sky. So if you're a complete novice, you can just get on and start using this telescope. The only thing you need to be able to know is where the compass bearing north is on your sight, and be able to level the telescope tube. And you don't have to do that to a critically high standard either. So I'm being asked what 2 alignment stars I want to do. Well, I'm just going to pick the ones right at the top here. I don't think there's any point in being overly elaborate, so I'm just going to go with Arcturus and Altair. Arcturus is showing up at the top, and Altair. And I'm going to hit the begin alignment button here. It's telling me now to level the telescope and point it due north. Well, I know due north is over here, so I'll put slacken off the locks, point the telescope north, and I'm going to set it level. Now, you'll notice I'm not using any gadgets, spirit levels or anything like that. Frankly, your judgment about it being level is probably good enough, just standing to one side and sort of looking, maybe comparing it with the brickwork on your house, or maybe the window on your house or something like that, or confirming the level along the horizon. That will actually do. The reason why this isn't a critical step is that the telescope is actually going to build a very simple mathematical model of any errors in the tripod leveling and the telescope tube leveling when you put the 2 guide stars in. So getting the guide stars right, that is important. Spend the moments doing that patiently and doing it well. Critically important, this: make sure you can see the whole field of the eyepiece. It's no good just peeping into the eyepiece and confirming that the alignment star is somewhere in the field of view. We need to be able to see the whole perimeter of the eyepiece so that you can actually be sure that the alignment star is in the center of the eyepiece field, or rather the field of the telescope. It's also critically important that your finder here is lined up correctly with the instrument as well. Suggest you do that during the day. Okay, I've leveled the telescope tube and pointed it north. So, press go. Telescope is immediately on its way to Arcturus. I'm getting a nice little display here telling me the amount, how far it's got to go to home in. We're working down to the 0 position there. Got a little way to go yet. So just talk amongst yourselves while it's doing this. Okay, there we go. It's overshoots very slightly and then winds it back. It does this to make sure that the gears are in a consistent position every time it makes its move, so that there's the minimum amount of vacillation in the motor system. This is asking for a move now. I can't actually directly select the star. It's asking me to manually center Arcturus, which I'm going to do, but it's requiring me to make a little adjustment, which I'm going to do blind. Obviously, we're not outside doing this, and I've made a little right hand and up adjustment. And in fact, that bar won't clear until I've hit a couple of keys, just very, very slightly to move the star, which I've now done. And I'm now going to press the star button to show that I've aligned it. Obviously, you would find the star in the finder. You would then make your adjustment of the telescope using the control arrow buttons here and make sure that the star is in the center of the eyepiece field. Just a little reminder to change the speed of the searching facility to move the move the telescope tube. I just hit these arrows here to speed it up. At the moment I'm using it on setting 9 so that you can see the movements. Don't forget, the movement I'm using to make the adjustment is far too aggressive at 9. You'd want to do use something much lower down, maybe 5 or 4 or something like that, to actually do the adjustment. Anyway, let's hit the button. It will go immediately now to the next alignment star, Altair. And once again, starts counting down. You can actually get a confirmation in the form of a vibration, you know, the silent buzz that your phone will make. And you can toggle that on if you want to get a warning that you can actually feel when the alignment process has been successful, or we've found the star. Okay, there we are, it's ready to go again. This time I can actually press the button directly. You would make your adjustments, find it in the finder, find it in the main tube, center it in the eyepiece field, and press the star button. And that's it, the alignment's been successful. We've got a confirmation of that across the bottom of the screen now. So now in principle, I can select a target from the menu and go directly to it. I press the back button. I can go on to star, go on to solar system. And at the moment, we've got 3 solar systemic targets on view. We've got the moon, Uranus and Neptune. Nothing big and bright in the sky just at the moment, but let's pick Uranus. Have a look at that. We can see information here. If I scroll up, if I just take that bottom screen out of the way, I can just scroll up and show you the details of the planet, its rise time, set time and transit time. And of course, it's going to show me the magnitude at 5.7, you can see there. So if I actually want to look at the target, all I've got to do is press go to. It's slowing at about 800 times sidereal now. When you're making manual slews, you can obviously slow that down and that'll take some of the noise out. I think it sounds as noisy as it probably does to you because the mic is actually very near the motors. And there you go. It's asking me to manually center Uranus. Now, Uranus will actually be in the center of the field of view. It will do this every time you make a move. So every time you go to a target, it's going to ask you to manually center. Now, this is actually a very nice feature of the mount because what it's doing here is actually getting rid of the tendency of the system to creep and gradually lose position, and also get rid of unwanted backlash depending on the direction that the telescope mount had actually moved in. So manually center Uranus, which I can do by bringing up the camera, the telescope control arrows here again, get that out of the way and just press accept, and that's done. Move to a new target. What should we have a look at here? Let's go back again, and this time we'll pick up a deep sky target. Let's go over there. We can pick a named deep sky target. We can go to tonight's best. And in the case you can see there of Messier targets, I can actually just put in a number, bring up the keypad at the bottom here again. So if I want to look at M31, I can put that on there. All I've got to do is press go to. Another important feature of this mount is the Freedom Find dual encoder system. We can see the switch for this on the settings menu. At the moment I've got it switched off. You can see it there, auxiliary encoder. I'm just going to toggle that to on. Just switch him up and then go back when I've done that operation. There it is, showing it's on. Probably worth bearing in mind that the as good as this feature is, it does erode the pointing accuracy of the mounting. Typical pointing accuracy is around about 10 arc minutes, so more than good enough to put the target you're looking for in the center of the field of a low power eyepiece very easily. It's going to be a little bit larger. It's going to widen that up from the central division, possibly to a disc as large as 20 arc minutes with the dual encoder on. The only thing I would say about the dual encoders, they are a great feature, especially if you're observing with children. Let's just show you the dual encoder system in action. I really think this is a very nice feature of the mounting. I think it's a great example of functional technology where the user doesn't really have to get too involved with it. It does its work kind of in the background, allowing the telescope to be used intuitively. At the moment, the instrument is pointed at Uranus. We did that alignment just a moment ago. I'm going to slacken off the locks here and then just move the telescope round. Let's just assume that we've seen something out the corner of our eye while we've been observing, and it's the most natural thing in the world to want to do with a telescope. Just disengage the locks and move it to a new position. Now, with a lot of telescopes not equipped with the Freedom Find dual encoders, we have now made an illegal move with the instrument, because we've lost our initial alignment. And to recover the functionality of being able to use Go-To, we would have to do the alignment again. But not so with the AZ-GTi. Even though we've moved to a new position, all we've got to do is make sure that we are still on Uranus on the display screen, and simply hit Go-To again. And it will go straight back to the target that we were looking at earlier. And that really is a nice trick. And this is achieved by this dual encoder system. We have a primary encoder to do the initial alignment of the drives, and then a secondary auxiliary encoder that records any movements that we make of the telescope with the locks undone. And you can see, this is a feature that really comes into its own when you're observing with children, children under 10, who have a tendency to want to touch the telescope and may accidentally pull it down to a new position. You can see this saves a lot of heartache by enabling you to move back to the target very, very easily. Don't get too confused though. It doesn't take account of us tripping over the tripod or anything like that. So if the tripod takes a wump, that's still going to be an illegal move, and the technology won't take care of that for you. Now, one little thing about this, if we just take a look at it, where the encoders are to be found, I just need to go on to the settings section just here. The auxiliary encoders are on at the moment. Obviously, I've just used those, but it's worth bearing in mind that the auxiliary encoder actually diminishes the overall pointing accuracy of the telescope. Pointing accuracy without the auxiliary encoder is around about 10 arc minutes. With them switched in, it does essentially simplify and make the pointing process a little cruder, so that the covering circle of the target is probably going to be quite a bit larger, so maybe even running up to about 20 arc minutes instead of 10 arc minutes that you would get, 10 arc minutes RMS that you would get with the mount without the auxiliary encoders on. I still think that's a fair trade. I think if you are observing on your own and you're not worried about moving the telescope off of alignment, then it's probably better to switch the encoders off. That's done very easily just pick that up and you've got a very simple switch there just to knock it off. It doesn't have to be done at any particular time. By taking it on, taking it off, even after you've done the alignment, initial alignment, all you've done now is restore the pointing accuracy of the mount without any difficulties. So that's your choice whether you have that in play or not. This is very much a feature-rich system. They've put a lot of useful accessory features on here. And I think the good thing about them is they're not in the user's face. You can find these things out and start using them, but there is no hidden things to be set up to actually get the telescope going. It's the app is remarkably free from what we might call unnecessary details. Yet at the same time, it's got the authority of these features because they are there when you want them. Let me give you a couple of examples of this. If we go on to the utility tool here, we've got a lot of information about the coordinates and the location, the hour angle, for example, local time. All this information is squirreled away. You can see it changing in real time here at the top of the screen. The information is there if you want it. Just hit back to go back to the screen again. Tracking options. At the moment we're toggled to sidereal, which is the standard option that it comes up in. We've got lunar, solar, and simple sun tracking as well. This is a very simple feature whereby we toggle it to simple sun tracking and the both motors will be active to provide about 15 minutes of good sun tracking, more than enough to make good observations, obviously providing your telescope is equipped with a full aperture solar filter or the instrument is a dedicated solar telescope. Let's go back again. We've got an identify option, so wherever the telescope is pointing, it will give you nearby objects. Let's just clear that out of the way. We can see nearby objects there with the target nearest the pointing position of the telescope obviously highlighted at the top of the screen. And we've got an option as well to hibernate the mounting. This gives us an opportunity really to shut the mount down with a known position so that we can bring it back to life again by moving it out of the hibernate home position. Down here in settings, that's the little cogwheel that we can see down here. Simply click on that. We've got information related to our location and we've got an opportunity underneath that tab to set the location specifically or simply use the onboard GPS system to pick that up. We can change the language, obviously. Night mode is on there. At the moment I've got it set to auto, but we can actually toggle it between day and night manually if we want to. And we've got a backlash control as well on it, which I think is quite surprising for such a relatively modest mounting. We can dial in the suspected backlash requirement. Very easy to use. Just sight up at the eyepiece and move the telescope around and increase these registers until the backlash is to an absolute minimum. Very useful, I think, if you were doing webcam imaging or something like that with it. Really quite a useful function on the AZ-GTi. Other features on here. We've got the Wi-Fi settings that we can examine as well at the bottom of that screen. Just go back to the top of it. Navigation-wise, it really couldn't be easier. Whenever you go down into a tab or one of these icons, you can always come back to the main menu either by hitting the back key at the top here, just do that again, or going to the menu button down in the corner here. Just give that a tap and it will take you straight back to the main menu. And there aren't hundreds of other menus, this is it. We can access all of this gravy through this very simple front end here. Now hopefully that's given you a good overview of the AZ-GTi mounting and the AZ-GTi telescope range. I know we skipped over the telescope tubes a little bit, the SkyMax 127, the SkyMax 102, and the Explorer 130 PS. We probably didn't give them the treatment they deserve, but don't forget we have dealt with them in our back catalogue fairly extensively quite recently. So if you want to take a more detailed view of them, follow the links and go back and take a look at some of that material. Suffice to say, they all come highly recommended, and they are very much more than a hop, skip and a jump above basic telescope levels. They all punch, I think, up to premium performance in their class. Combine these excellent tubes with this Wi-Fi connectability robotic altazimuth mounting system, and I think you've got a very competent introduction to telescopic astronomy. Rather more than that, I think it's a very elegant introduction as well. I think the whole idea of going from something that we already know and love, our intimate relationship with our favorite smartphone, either on iOS or on Android, and to go from that to the fairly challenging complexities of a modern robotic telescope mount, I think in principle that was a great idea. I think in practice other companies have tried it and I think haven't got it quite right. They've tried too hard, and they've tried to go with graphic interfaces that look nice but really don't deliver a bomb-proof performance. I think SkyWatcher have got it right. I think they've gone with a system that is simple, straightforward, and just removes the fear of failure, I think, from the user. And it's a very attractive way of connecting to the telescope and being able to make discoveries of the night sky. And I think that overall that makes these exceptional starter telescopes. And I think there's a lesson here for the future in the way this type of system is going to be used. For a moment there, connecting telescopes to iOS and Android tablets and smartphones was beginning to look like a novelty act that wasn't going to stay the course. I think now that we've seen SkyWatch's implementation of it, I think it's definitely something that's here to stay. And I don't think this is going to curry favour only with the entry-level users. I think this telescope is sophisticated enough, or rather this mounting is sophisticated enough, to engage the more hardened user who is looking for grab-and-go convenience, especially amongst the specialist observers, solar observers, people using small hydrogen alpha scopes, for example. I think you're going to find this a very attractive option. I think there's a whole class of people who want to do photography with this type of mounting who are going to find it attractive as well. So I definitely think it's got legs and is going to find favour with a very broad class of potential users. And that's definitely got to be the hallmark of an important piece of equipment. And I think we're going to be seeing products like this from SkyWatcher, I'm sure, in the future, because they've really hit a winning recipe with this one. Anyway, that's it for the AZ-GTi. Don't forget to subscribe, and we look forward to seeing you soon. Bye for now.